He'll be in our Washington studios to discuss his new book, Serbs and Croats, The Struggle in Yugoslavia. That's Sunday on C-SPAN, the companion network of C-SPAN 2, beginning at 8 p.m. and 11 p.m. Eastern Time.
Next, we take you to the campus of the American University here in Washington, D.C., for a forum which is titled Malcolm X the Movie, Cinema as History. Taking part in Monday night's program were Juan Williams of the Washington Post, National Public Radio film critic Pat Dowell, Richmond Free Press columnist Peter Bailey, and Jacquie Jones, the editor of the Black Film Review. Malcolm X cast member Al Freeman Jr. also took part in the panel discussion. You may recall in the movie, Mr. Freeman played the black Muslim leader Elijah Muhammad. Mr. Freeman is currently the chairman and artistic director of Howard University's Theater Arts Department. We take you now to the American Forum program, which was moderated by Sanford Ungar, the dean of the American University's School of Communication.
I'm Sanford Ungar, dean of the School of Communication here at American University, and want to welcome all of you who are with us in the K Chapel on the American University campus, as well as those who will later see this forum on C-SPAN or listen to it on National Public Radio through the assistance of WAMU-FM. Our subject this evening is Malcolm X, the movie, Cinema as History. We'll explore a subject that we have explored before, namely the role of a film that is made on a historical figure or a series of historical events and what its contribution to us is intended to be, should be, can be, etc. Our thanks, especially this evening, as usual, to the Xerox Foundation, the Washington Gas Light Company, and Cable Holdings, whose generosity have made these forums possible. We'll have about an hour of discussion and then welcome your questions from the audience. If you'll come to the microphone in the center aisle, I will call on you, ask you to identify yourself and state your questions briefly, and we'll try to give you brief answers. Immediately following the forum, there will be a reception in the private dining room on the first floor of Mary Graydon Center along the Quad. I want to introduce our guests this evening, our participants in the forum. To my immediate left is Jacquie Jones, who is the editor of Black Film Review and the executive editor of One, Washington's new newspaper on progressive black politics and culture. She's also a contributor to the anthologies Black Popular Culture, Black American Cinema, and associate editor for the film journal Cineast. To her left is Peter Bailey, a columnist at the Richmond Free Press and an editor of Songs of Freedom, an oral history project on the civil rights movement in Virginia's capital. He teaches a course on the black press at Virginia Commonwealth University. And one of the reasons he is of particularly with us this evening is that he was a close associate of Malcolm X and was with him on the day that he was assassinated in 1965. To his left is Christopher Hitchens, who writes a regular column called Minority Reports for The Nation magazine, another called Cultural Elite for Vanity Fair. Christopher Hitchens started his journalism career with the Times of London as a social science correspondent, later was foreign editor for The New Statesman and is the author of many books. To my right is Al Freeman Jr., chairman and artistic director of Howard University's Theater Arts Department. He has a particular reason for being here tonight too, in that he is a veteran actor who portrayed Elijah Muhammad, the black Muslim leader, in the movie Malcolm X, and we're particularly grateful to Al Freeman Jr. for taking the time to be here as a member of the cast of the movie. His career spans more than 30 years. He's performed on and off Broadway and won awards for his Emmys for his portrayal, actually, of Malcolm X in Roots 2 and for his work in soap operas. To his right is Pat Dowell, film critic for National Public Radio, WETA-FM, In These Times, and various other media. Her articles have appeared in The Washington Post, Baltimore Sun, many other places. She is associate editor for the film journal Cineast and lectures on film at local universities. And to her right is Juan Williams, political analyst and national correspondent for the Washington Post. He He is the author of the nonfiction bestseller Eyes on the Prize, America's Civil Rights Years, 1954 to 65. And Juan is now writing a biography of the late Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall. His writings have appeared in many places, and he's often seen on television programs discussing the news. We are going to begin our forum this evening by showing a few clips from Malcolm X. Let me pause first and ask, how many people in the room have seen Malcolm X? Quite a few. And how many of you have seen it more than once? Only a few. Okay. For those who haven't, we thought, and for those who have, to remind you of some things about the film, we thought we would show just a few quick clips of the film and then proceed to our discussion. Now, I think that means that some of us are going to have to move. No? We're all right? Okay.
You go busting your fist against a stone wall. You're not using your brain. That's what the white man wants you to do. Look at you, putting all that poison in your hair.
I think you've been in prison too long, my man, because everybody on the outside counts.
Why? Why does everybody on the... You can't bust out of here like they do in the movies. Because even if you get out, you're still in prison.
Man, you ain't lying there.
You go busting your fist against a stone wall. You're not using your brain. That's what the white man wants you to do. Look at you, putting all that poison in your hair.
I think you've been in prison too long, my man, because everybody on the outside counts.
Why? Why does everybody on the outside count?
Because they don't want to walk around with a nappy head looking like...
Looking like what? Like me? Like a nigger? Why don't you want to look like what you are? What makes you ashamed of being black?
Let me tell you something. I'm not ashamed of being anything. You better get your hands off me. I got to wash this out.
Let it burn, nigger. Get your hands off of me. Go on. Burn yourself. Pain yourself. Put all that poison in your hair, in your body, trying to be white. I thought you were smart. Are you just another one of those cats strutting down the avenue in your clown suit with all that meth on you, looking like a monkey? The white man sees you and laughs. He laughs because he knows you ain't white.
Man, who are you?
No, the question is, who are you? How did we get this mind? You're not an American. You're an African who happens to be an American. You have to understand the difference. We didn't come over on the Nita, the Pinta, and the whatchamacallit. We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on us. Landed right on top of us.
Shorty? Is that you, brother? Praise be to Allah. Now, this is exactly what I'm talking about, the slave mentality, the slave mind. This brother and I, we had the slave mind. We used to rob together. We used to sleep with white women. We even went to prison together. Now, don't be surprised when I say we went to prison, because some of y'all still in prison right now. Prisons of your mind. Stand up, brother. Come on.
The brother's a little shy. Come on, brother. Give me a hug. That's all right, brother. That's all right. Look, he still got his hair fried. That's all right, though. That's the slave mind.
man to see Brother Johnson.
Who the hell are you?
I'm the minister for Muslim Temple number 7.
Never heard of you.
Where is he?
Nobody here by that name.
Wait a second. What is your name, fella?
Don't worry about what my name is. Two witnesses saw Brother Johnson brought in here beat up. Nobody saw him brought out.
You didn't hear the sergeant? Outside.
I suggest you look outside that window.
Jimmy, come here a second.
Yes, we intend to see Brother Johnson.
Who the hell are they supposed to be?
They're brothers of Brother Johnson.
Eddie, let me take a look at that blotter.
We got a Muslim. Relief must have put it down.
Must have.
Yeah, but you can't see him because you ain't his lawyer.
No lawyer, no see.
Well, until I'm satisfied that Brother Johnson is receiving proper medical care, nobody will move.
Tonight, I shall introduce you as my national minister. It will be a difficult task. Your assignment is to build temples all over this nation. More work than you've ever done in your life.
Yes, sir.
You will be in the public eye. Beware of them cameras. Oh, them cameras are bad as any narcotic. White Devil will be watching you every step. And your own brothers will be jealous, hostile. Go slowly.
Yes, sir.
Today, my friends are black, red, yellow, brown and white.
Malcolm, are you prepared to go to the United Nations at this point and ask that charges be brought against the United States for its treatment of the American Negroes?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. The audience will have to be quiet.
Please, please. Yes, as I stated earlier, that those nations, African nations, Latin nations, Asian nations, are very hypocritical when they stand up in the UN and denounce the racism practiced in South Africa and at the same time say absolutely nothing about the practice of racism here in American society. Now, I wouldn't be a man if I didn't do so. I would not be a man.
Are you prepared now to work with some of the other leaders of some of the other civil rights organizations?
Yes, we're prepared to work with any groups, leaders, organizations, as long as they're genuinely interested in results, positive results.
Al Freeman, Jr. What was your purpose, or what do you feel was the purpose in making this film? Is this intended as a historical statement?
I'm not sure about that. My purpose was that I had somewhat of a connection to the film from its beginning. Years ago, when Marvin Wirth bought the property, the autobiography, for Columbia Pictures, and developed four scripts that were not acceptable to Columbia, and later Warners bought the project, and I had a film at the time of a Leroy Jones play that Warners asked to see, which they didn't want to distribute, but they asked me to if I would like to direct the autobiography of Malcolm X. It turned out that the version they wanted to use was Arnold Pearl's version. By the way, Arnold Pearl did not write the version that has his name on it. That version was a compilation of all the stock footage of Malcolm from the first time Mike Wallace alerted America to this monolithic black group that was out do terrible things all the way to Malcolm's assassination. What they didn't understand was how to incorporate the autobiography into that format, and I suppose that was to be my job, but I couldn't figure that out either, and suggested that they should start all over again, which they were not going to do, so they went ahead and made that movie. So for me, later on, of course, I played Malcolm in Roots 2, and this was the full circle for me. So that's the reason why I did it, in any case. What was your other question?
My other question is whether it's a historical document, whether this is a piece of history or a piece of entertainment or a piece of politics.
Probably all those things, I suppose. I think Spike set out to do the autobiography, and only that, for which he's been criticized in many instances. There's one student at Howard, for instance, that called the film the second assassination of Malcolm X because of its omissions of Malcolm's life toward the end. But I think that's what Spike set out to do, was to really be faithful to the biography, and I think he did that.
Peter Bailey, you were with Malcolm X on the day that he died, and I wonder how you view this film. Do you see this as something that rings true for you, or does it have another purpose?
Well, being a person who was involved with Brother Malcolm, I don't expect a movie on Malcolm X that I would really like to be come out of financed by Warner Brothers. That's where I started from, you know. Mm-hmm. So I always give credit when a black person is able to get something out of a system like that. And Spike did what I think probably as well as he could have done, considering that this is a Hollywood movie. And we know what Hollywood has done to black people throughout its history. So I did not go to the movie expecting to see, quote, the truth. I just wanted to see what Spike was going to do with it and hope that not too much damage was done to the Malcolm X that I knew. And I don't think that he did. I don't think there was very much damage done at all to him. I think that for young people who have not read the book and who probably will not read the autobiography, I always tell them that the movie should be a starting point. And then they go from there to learn more about him. My own personal feeling about what I consider to be the most serious flaw in the movie is the overemphasis on the big red part of his life and almost total lack of clarity on that very, very crucial last year.
When you say the big red part of his life, you mean the early stages when he was basically a hustler?
When he was running through the streets and, you know, and wearing those zoot suits and all of that. I mean, that's Hollywood. And I think there was too much of that. I mean, you could have dealt with that about 15 to 20 minutes and then moved on. And by and doing that, I think that then that crucial last few years of his life, especially his international thrust, because if you do not understand his international thrust, then you will fall for this whole idea that is being perpetrated, that the United States government had no interest, as one writer has written, really did not care enough about what Malcolm X was doing to be concerned about him. And we know better than that. And by not focusing on that, it leaves the impression that the assassination of Malcolm X was just another argument between a bunch of black folks, and one of them ended up killing the other one, when those of us who were involved know that that was not the case. The United States government, as far as I am concerned, was very much involved and very much desired that Malcolm X not be around. And that does not come through clear enough in the movie.
I wonder, I think we should ask each of our film critics on this panel. Pat Dowell, how do you put together the various purposes of this movie, and what do you think it represents?
Well, I had very mixed feelings when I went to see Malcolm X, because I've admired Spike Lee as a filmmaker, and I thought it was by far the most conventional of any of his movies. And that aspect I found disappointing, because I thought that he would bring the same kind of really incisive techniques that he brought to, say, Do the Right Thing to this film. But it was very clear, I thought, what he wanted to do. You know, he was often quoted when this film was about to be released as saying that young kids, young black kids, should leave school, should skip school one day and go see Malcolm X. He later sort of retracted that. It wasn't quite what he said anyway. But the reason that he felt that way was because when he was a child, he had been taken out of school to go see Gone with the Wind. And it was very clear that he was determined to right that wrong and to make a black epic that did the same kind of thing, that had the same sort of sweep and historical breadth and the same mythic proportions, I think, that Gone with the Wind had for kids like him who were forced to see it, or had for white kids, and he was forced to see it. He wanted to make sure that he could answer Gone with the Wind, I think. I think that's very clear.
Does it answer Gone with the Wind?
In its own way, it does. You know, it works better as myth than as history, and for all its... I say that it's a very conventional film, and I think it is. It's a very conventional biopic that mythologizes the man whose life it portrays. But it works rather well as myth, and within the confines of being very conventional, I think that it's a rather good teaching tool, an introductory course in Malcolm X, if you will, a kind of, one might almost say, a Malcolm X made easy, made accessible to a very large audience. And, you know, I mean, I'm disappointed that it's not a better film than it is, but I'm impressed that it's as good a film as it is.
Jacquie Jones.
Well, one thing I'd like to say is I completely agree with Peter, and the thing that's always baffled me about kind of the pre-press for this movie was that people seem to be expecting Malcolm X as a movie to be some sort of functional political document for black people, and I don't know how anyone in this country can expect Hollywood to produce such a document. I mean, the whole point of Hollywood is to maintain status quo, and in a society like ours, that kind of mandates a certain kind of marginalization of African Americans and African American history. And so I think what's important about the film is kind of what Pat said, that it is, or I think what Peter also said, it's kind of a beginning point to look at Malcolm X, but it also makes a case for a certain kind of legitimacy of the Malcolm X myth. And I think in America, where most of our historical figures are judged by things that they do, you know, freeing slaves, integrating schools, whatever, there's been sort of a tension around Malcolm X because, more than anything else, he was a leader in the area of thought, and he was a philosopher. And he's one of the first people that I know of, black people, that really criticized the media and really looked constructively at how television and how Hollywood really represented us and what we got out of that. So I think the film does a good job at kind of filling in, even, you know, on a pretty rudimentary level, what Malcolm X has always meant, I think, for black people. So I think that for what it is as a Hollywood biopic, I thought it was really good. I thought it was a great starting point. I would hope that people would go from there and try to know more than they'll get from the film, but then, you know, the film at least gives them more than they got from the cap. So I think, you know, it's a progress.
Is that expecting a lot, that people will go on to learn more? Does the average movie-going audience really... Do that?
No, and I mean the thing about you know, our heroes and our icons is that very few people really know what Thomas Jefferson did, you know, or why he was important. And I think that it is a bit much, and I think it's one of the problems with black films and black culture in general is that there's this whole theory that they should mean more than what they mean. Mm-hmm. I mean, Malcolm X is a movie. It's a piece of popular culture. I mean, I think it's important in terms of institutionalizing a myth, an African-American myth, the same way that other Hollywood films do that. And not that Malcolm X's legacy is nothing more than a myth, but it is part of American mythology.
But what you're saying... I'm sorry, go ahead, Pat.
It is worth noting that the hype surrounding the film, the tremendous publicity preceding the film's release and upon its release, obviously did help to catapult the autobiography back to the top of the bestseller list. So obviously for some people it was a starting point.
Yeah. And that after many years.
Well, it's sold well, increasingly well actually, ever since it was published. Mm-hmm. But it went right to the top of the bestseller list in paperback as the film was coming out.
Juan Williams, you've written and done for public television, history of the civil rights movement. And I wonder whether this film has made you rethink the role of Malcolm X in that history.
Well, it's an interesting question because I think one of the functions of caring about the history is thinking about it all the time. So,
sure.
Of course, I experience the film and I rethink what I'm thinking, but I don't think it has caused me to revise my conception of Malcolm's place in American history to any substantial extent. And I think the answer to your question is that this movie really is not about history. I think it is a drama in terms of what Jacquie and Pat said. I think it's presented as Hollywood. And secondly, it's about contemporary politics in that it speaks to the current political appetite that exists in America for Malcolm X as a defiant and strong black male figure in the society. And secondly, speaks to the idea of the acceptability now of Malcolm X in terms of modern American political discourse, so that you can have someone stand up and speak out in anger about the way that whites have historically oppressed black people in the society, and then see him go through that tremendous metamorphosis that I think is the heart of Malcolm X's story, where he becomes an educated man and he goes through so many transformations. And you can hold this up to the society, therefore, as acceptable, whereas I think previously Malcolm X was a very threatening symbol to American society, particularly to white American society and to middle-class black American society as well. I think now Malcolm X is more of an acceptable figure for many reasons, not the least of which is that people want sort of to defang him at this point and to make him acceptable.
Well, see, that's where I did. I don't think the Malcolm X that they want is more acceptable. The real Malcolm X, who was planning on taking the United States government before the UN up until the day he died, the real Malcolm X is still not acceptable to this country. It is only what they are trying to do is what they do is pull out. I think there are two kinds of people who basically talk about the big change in Malcolm X. Those of us who were involved with him said that the big change in Malcolm X was when he went from being Big Red to being Malcolm X, not when he went from being, you know, the post-Mech and pre-Mech, all that St. Paul, you know, type of attitude that many people have about that. Malcolm X, the Malcolm X that I knew, this is still very unacceptable to this country. If I got out there right now and started speaking the real Malcolm X to people, it would be just as unacceptable now as it was then. And those of us who were involved with him, he probably will remain unacceptable because we are not going to allow them to what we call deball him, which is what they did to the real Martin Luther King. The real Martin Luther King is now Martin Luther, I Have a Dream King. The man who disrupted whole cities, who became the dominant force in the war against Vietnam, no longer is hardly exists about Martin Luther King. But we're not going to allow that to happen to Malcolm X. And so I don't think Malcolm X is acceptable at all. I think that they pull out one part of him, you know, the self-help thing, which some black people try to claim began with the so-called black conservatives, but which has been a part of black history for several hundred years. They pull that out, and that becomes what they talk about. But I am sure that, for instance, Clarence Thomas would not be supporting the Malcolm X, who up until he died had very definite plans on taking this country before the United Nations for violating the human rights of black people. That's the Malcolm X that was assassinated on February 21st, 1965.
Well, you happen to be wrong. You know, in fact, I wrote a piece for GQ, which I talked to you for, about how people like Thomas and the black conservatives are now quite happy and quite anxious to adapt and adopt Malcolm. I mean, they don't even have to adopt. I mean, maybe that's the wrong word, because these are young people who grew up reading the autobiography. These are young people who have taken Malcolm really as kind of the spark that heightened their consciousness in terms of the black nationalist movement in terms of late 60s, early 70s. These are people who were in college during that period who've not come into the middle class and into power in American society as black people, and always felt Malcolm was to some extent their secret, you know, that they knew about Malcolm and they loved Malcolm. And those people actually appreciate Malcolm as this challenging figure, because he still speaks in their mind, I think, to white America in terms of saying, we're not there yet, you know, and his prophetic statements still carry so much energy and so much power, I think even for this generation of Americans, that they are glad to have him. So it's an interesting embrace, but it's not the case that they would be uncomfortable with him.
You know, that's really is very curious what you're saying, Juan, because as both of you were talking, I was thinking that before Spike got involved with this movie, or perhaps even around that time, there seemed to be in the minds of many young black people, as you have said, that appropriated Malcolm for their own sort of cult mythic reasons, that made a climate for this film to be made at somehow having been made, and as it is, sort of diffused a bit of that, and which is a very curious thing.
which is not what Spike Lee would have expected to happen.
Yeah, neither would I. So this is just a thought that occurred to me listening to Juan and Peter talking there.
Christopher Hitchens?
I've got a friend in Jerusalem. He's an old resistance fighter from Europe called Israel Shahak, who now lives in Israel and defends the human and the national rights of the Palestinians. And whenever I call him up and say, how are things? He's prone to reply, well, Christopher, he says, there are encouraging signs of polarization. And the fact that he knows how to think that way, and most people don't, and are afraid of confrontation and of polarization, and indeed always use those words as if they were pejorative, whereas if you can claim to be a healer or a unifier, you're axiomatically privileged in American society, should make us wonder why it is that actually the consensus has somewhat managed to absorb this movie. It seems to me people underestimate all the time the fantastic equipment of shock absorption that this consensus has. Now, I would say the book drove me to read the autobiography again and to read James Baldwin's original script for the first time, and also to read another book that's very interesting, which is Spike Lee's own compilation of the book of the movie. Contains a lot of the original interviews he did. And I think I'd like to offer just some reasons why I think the consensus has absorbed it. Partly that's by the will of the critics and most people who write in this country, because when they can absorb, when they can say that something is healing or entertaining, they will. And partly I think it is Spike Lee's fault that it was so easily assimilable into the general wet blanket of cultural discussion in the United States. If you consider the autobiography, the movie interview book that's just called X, you can get in any bookstore paperback, and the Baldwin script, you'll find four important things I think that are missing or have been rendered blandly. Some critics point out there are some autobiographical details. I think my comrade on the right is quite correct in saying there's much too much show-off stuff of the early pimp days, the Malcolm Little days. Partly that's also to give Spike Lee a chance to show off in his zoot suit, let's not forget.
Which won an Oscar nomination,
yeah. Which is the bit that gets the Oscar, which I wasn't displeased to see. It was quite fun and so on. Then there are things where we, even those of us who admire him, can't be certain that the author of the autobiography was telling the truth about his father and about the torching of his own house, which is blamed on other black militants, possibly rightly, possibly not, maybe was self-inflicted torching, but these are just done uncritically. These are where it's too authentic in following the book, too faithful, I mean to say. Then there is the relationship between Malcolm X and two very interesting and very diverse political groups way outside the American consensus. The first of these is the Socialist Workers' Party, a Trotskyist, internationalist, Marxist group with which Malcolm X was working increasingly closely at the time he was murdered, which was considered to the left of the left and was very much persecuted by the communist and fellow traveling consensus, which had a large part in the soft center of the civil rights movement. A hard internationalist group with which he, especially in Harlem, he was moving to have relations. The second out group is, of course, the Nation of Islam. Now, since Spike Lee put Farrakhan into Do the Right Thing, where he really had basically no place, no business, and Spike Lee has in the book of the movie a very long and very tough interview with Farrakhan about his relations with Malcolm X, and where the question comes up, Farrakhan called in his papers and other editorials in the same papers called for the murder of Malcolm X, And this is discussed and confronted by Spike Lee, who used also the Nation of Islam's youth movement as security for the movie. How come that he just dodges the whole question? How come that the you wouldn't know there was such a person then or now, and there's both, in the whole film? How come that this hard, sharp question is simply left out? We know that Mr. Lee knew of its presence there. Now, I think that if you do leave out these things, there are rewards from critics who say how much you are maturing and how increasingly you earn your place in the respectable consensus, and indeed you may get Academy Award nominations, but you cannot complain if the big embrace moves around to say, well, at least you know how to avoid confrontation. The only thing that brings life to politics or to thought.
I don't have very much criticism of that, because Farrakhan at that time was not a big force in the Nation of Islam. He really wasn't during the time when Malcolm X was alive. And I think Spike very clearly in that movie, and this is of course the people that I know who are supporters of the Nation, have been very upset about that. Makes it appear that the Nation was the instrument for the assassination of Malcolm X. My criticism, and I bring it back to again to what I was saying earlier, that it is no way that you can tell me that the so-called black conservatives agreed that the United States should be taken before the United Nations Commission for violating the human rights of black people. I wonder if they believe in self-defense. I wonder if they believe in black power. These were all things. You cannot believe in black power and get put on the Supreme Court, you know, and get made vice president of IBM. You know, if they were carrying out these beliefs, this man was about the empowerment, not integration, not separation, not desegregation. He was about power. And the people who claim that they support him are not doing anything about that. In fact, we say that the basic argument between the Clarence Thomases, the Shelby Steeles, and the Thomas Sowells, and the Jesse Jacksons, the Andy Youngs, and the Benjamin Hooks is over which group of white folks do you attach yourself to? The liberals are the conservatives, the Democrats are the Republicans. Neither of those factions is talking about empowering the black community, and that is what Malcolm X was about. You cannot say that you believe in or support or identify with the philosophy of Malcolm X if that is not your focus of your conversation and your action.
And I'd just like to add to that, and I think that you have to keep in mind also that the audience for this film generally really isn't people that knew Malcolm X as Peter did, or people that have a real grasp of the historical moment. And part of, I think, what the support for Malcolm, where that's come from, is this kind of a feeling that the integration thing has played out, you know, that it hasn't helped the majority of African-American youths that, you know, live in inner cities, or even middle-class black kids that now see, like, a resurgence of racism and are resegregating themselves. I think when you look at, you know, what's come out of rap music, which basically is where the film, how the film was made, is that you see exactly what Peter's talking about, that I think a lot of black youth have just completely given up on black leadership, and that reaching back to Malcolm X is the strongest, most effective model that they see for self-determination.
I want to come to you, Al Freeman, on this issue of the things that were left out, that Christopher Hitchens raised. I know you're not responsible for the script, obviously.
I'm not.
and yet I wonder how you react to some of what he said about some of these things being left out of the film, in that sense being sort of sanitized.
Well, actually, you know, that was what went through my mind the first time around. I mean, I read all those scripts that were developed, the Calder-Willingham script, the James Baldwin treatment, the James Baldwin script, and none of them for speaking to the kind of Malcolm that I wanted to see on the screen. But of course, Warner Brothers at that time did not want to even get into that. So later on, here we are, and it's going round, and I believe a lot of people were expecting to see all those kinds of omissions, that kind of confrontation, and some answers to some very deep questions about who and what and why was Malcolm assassinated. And I don't think that I believe it was deliberately left out by Spike, because he wanted to, he hinted at it very broadly, I think. He didn't name anybody specific, but it was pretty clear that there were some establishment kind of forces that were at work there. And of course, we all know that Malcolm was not admitted into France after he left Mecca. For what reason? He wasn't admitted in. The Brits wouldn't let him in either for what reason? And that his organization was going to have a global kind of constituency. That was enough to alarm a lot of people.
Well, that the assumption there is that the United States asked France and Britain not to let Malcolm X in.
We've heard that, and that's quite possible. I don't know, but it was clear that it was some Western influence, certainly, because the Cold War was still on, mm-hmm. and Mr. Hitchens is actually right that Malcolm did have some leftist connections there, and of course Nasser was assassinated, so was Tambo, so was Cabral, all those people who were assassinated, and Malcolm, we were all assassinated at the same time. I mean, it's a Cold War thing, clearly, and but I don't think, you know, at the kickoff dinner that Spike gave, Peter was there, and there were a lot of people giving advice to Spike about how he should make
requested advice.
Yeah, right. It was. One was Benjamin 2X, who said quite openly that if there were any explicit sex scenes of Malcolm, that the film was going to have a lot of trouble. He said, remember Salman Rushdie? Yes, well, you see, I think that was something Spike heard quite clearly that night, and certain scenes got altered in the film as a result of that.
You know, that's an extraordinary statement that a director would labor under that kind of pressure. This is not an ordinary film in that case. This is not the usual process. I mean, I'm sure there are lots of people who put pressure on the people who are making films, but...
Are you saying then that a director in this country could make a film and, let's say, for instance, show Thomas Jefferson in bed with Sally Hemings? Or Robert E. Lee, you know, cavorting with one of his, you know, his slave women? You know, I mean, let's be real. This is a real world that we
probably
live in.
Wouldn't be threatened, you know, with death.
Oh, I think they could.
And
you'd be threatened with economic ruin.
Right.
Instead of actual assassination, if he were to do that. And in fact, people certainly have written about Thomas Jefferson.
There's a
in
difference
that light
in,
as well.
There's a vast difference in writing about something and putting it on screen.
Well,
you know, a vast difference in the audience that you're going to reach. I think that I was there that evening when that statement was made. And
how did you react to that, Peter, to that statement?
Well, I was a little bit apprehensive about the Salman Rushdie reference, but if anything that kept that movie from being sleazy, or what I considered, see, I think that I might be considered a prude. I think that American movies have become, you know, some of the absolute sleaziest things on the face of the earth. This is all of them, mainly, television, the whole works. So to do that with Malcolm X would, in my opinion, have been something that Spike, if he took that advice, he was an extremely wise person.
I just want to ask you a clarifying question. I think I know what you mean about Jefferson and Sally and so on, but I think, would you say it was the same thing that you would have a very hard time getting a film dramatization of J. Edgar Hoover's tapes of Martin Luther King in the motel onto TV now, either? And if...
You
oh, I'm sorry.
Christopher, it's very hard
sorry,
to hear you.
If I'm not audible. I was just taking Mayor Corey Peter.
You probably would. I mean, people would get very upset.
Maybe I should have the
whether question. Or not they would be able to stop it. I don't know, but I do know that people, probably the King people, and I'm assuming this, because they gave up so much to get that holiday that I'm not quite sure what else they're prepared to give up to get a movie. On the real Martin Luther King as opposed to the I Have a Dream Martin Luther King. I mean, They gave up a tremendous amount on him to get the holiday. So I'm not sure what else they would give up in order to get a movie done.
I mean, the other night on PBS, there was, in effect, footage of J. Edgar Hoover in a dress. As a transvestite hooker in the Plaza Hotel.
Well, there was not, actually, in fact.
You know, well, in,
there were hints of
there
this.
Was more than, no, it was more than hint. There was testimony from living witnesses. I thought it was the perfect revenge for Hoover's prurient taping of other people. I thought it was, as is Anthony Summers' book,
And I bet you that will end up in a movie. Which is, I think we'll see J. Edgar Hoover in a dress.
I think we will see J. Edgar Hoover in a little nice black little number strutting up and down. It will happen. And the reason I'm saying this is I do think actually all these things are not only possible, but probably necessary.
Well, I don't think you can, to me, you can't compare. See, J. Edgar Hoover has been exposed. When you're talking about Malcolm X to me as a black person, then with a white person, you're talking about, you know, Thomas Jefferson. You don't compare Malcolm X with J. Edgar Hoover.
All right, fair enough.
You know, and if you're going to compare him, you compare him with the Thomas Jeffersons and the George Washingtons and the Robert E. Lees, you know, and those kind of people, and how they are treated, the lies that have been told about them in movies and books
to glamorize them,
and everything. For centuries, these lies have been told. I feel lucky in having gotten to know Brother Malcolm is that I personally don't have to look upon him, you know, as a myth, as a god. I can see him as a great black man, not a great man, as a great black man. And so that's what I am looking for. I can see his flaws. I can say that he should not have said the chicken's coming home to roost. Not because it was not true, because it was very accurate, but for political reasons, it provided his enemies with ammunition against him. That's the only reason he should not have said it. The statement itself was very accurate.
I want to change the subject for a moment, if I can, because someone said before that this film was made more acceptable, was toned down in order to get more, in order to be accepted into the consensus, to get more Academy Award nominations. It did not get very many Academy Award nominations.
Got two.
It got two. One for costumes.
Yes, one for Denzel Washington.
Right.
Which is certainly well-deserved. And it's very strange. In fact, I was even surprised that when people reported on the Academy Award nominations, you didn't hear more people saying, well, the big surprise is that, you know, the Academy hasn't given more nominations to Malcolm X. Because, in fact, what we've discussed here is some of its flaws, you know, it's the kind of conventionality and appeal to a large audience and kind of smoothing off the rough edges to be appealing to a large audience. And the mythologizing are all things that in a normal Academy year would make them want to shower it with nominations. And I think that Spike Lee is not appealing to the average Academy voter. I think it's pretty clear from this year's nominations, it's more of an outrage, I think, that they ignored Do the Right Thing a few years ago than it is that they ignored this film.
Are you saying it wasn't sanitized enough to get more Academy Award nominations? Is that what you're saying?
Well, actually, no. I think that it's really probably, there's an element of racism in it, because there always is when you're talking about black people and white people in America. But I think that the Academy has a problem with Spike Lee personally, with his style, with his love of the outrageous publicity statement, you know, his challenges, his verbal challenges to the Hollywood establishment, that you have to say, to some extent, he would like to be a part of, I think, and would like to be recognized by. And it's an irony for, you know, for him that he can't, that here, I think he really put himself out to please Hollywood, and he couldn't please them enough. And the film has gotten surprisingly few Academy nominations, but even more surprising than that is the fact that it's, you know, you mentioned earlier when we were backstage that it's not in theaters now.
Yeah, it seems to have disappeared from the theaters
very quickly. In a way, from the sort of public discourse, that surprises me more. I thought, considering the amount of controversy that preceded it, I'm surprised that it is not still, you know, on the front burner, if you will. And I think part of that is due to the aggressive way in which it was marketed, to some extent, by Spike Lee himself. I mean, once you, you know, part of the reason why Malcolm X as a figure is more easily assimilated, because, you know, in this movie and as the hero of this movie, is because he was merchandised so well in advance that it's pretty hard to find him challenging or controversial after, you know, people have his symbol, his last name, X, if you will, plastered all over their hats and their shirts and, you know, on key rings and whatever else. I mean, it's another way of making him into a commodity, literally.
But it's not a good sell at the movie houses, is it? For 3.5 hours, I mean, you can
only... Well, that's a problem that theater owners don't like because they can only show it once a night,
right,
and they make less money. And you had, and there were curious things connected with the showing of this film in theaters, with its run. You remember that very odd controversy, that little scandal in two or three places where people were getting tickets with different names, you know, being sold tickets for, you know, what... I don't know, can't remember what was out in the fall, but they were being sold tickets that had the name of another film playing in the same theater,
what
which meant that when the grosses were tallied up, it might not have been getting its fair share if that was a widespread thing. Although I've never heard of that kind of scandal connected with any other film.
Well, wasn't it curious Warner's reaction to that? That it was.
Well, they sort of played it down. Well, it
what did they say?
It was their money.
Yeah, it's their money that's being lost, and they were sort of like, well, we just think it's, you know, one or two times it's happened, but it's not a big deal. It's not happening on a large scale. And it really wouldn't be of advantage to a theater owner unless he was trading tickets for Malcolm X with tickets for some film that he'd been playing for a longer time, which is when theater owners begin to make money off of a movie after they've played it for several weeks. But
any other thoughts about why it has sort of faded so quickly from public attention, from public discourse, from the theaters? Why didn't it get more nominations? Jacquie?
Well, I think one thing is, I think people were disappointed in it. Both black and white. I think people expected to be made more angry by the film. Mm-hmm. I think they expected it to be a more angry kind of a film, and I think what Spike tried to do was kind of humanize the anger that had been marketed before. So I think that, you know, there were, before the film opened, there was this idea that white people would be up in arms about it because there would be all this racist rhetoric and black people would be moved to, you know, take to the streets, and that's not what the film was. And I think that once that got out, and once, as Christopher Hitchens was saying, that once all the critics said, oh, this is a wonderful movie, and, you know, that it kind of took the sting off of it, really.
I may say that I saw a very agreeable thing. I went with Walter Mosley to see it in New York, the showing, and I saw something I'd like to see more often, real fear on the faces of Warner Brothers executives and publicity people who were sort of guarding the entrance to the cinema. They really thought that night might end in some kind of
this
riot.
This was the night of the opening.
Yeah, and it was amazing to see, and I realized how much I like to see publicity people look frightened, and I don't see it enough. And then I realized that, in fact, of course, that it was all in their minds. It must be some kind of guilt complex, I suppose. They don't think the subject can come up without the threat of violence. That is a compliment of a kind to the subject, but the fact is, you wouldn't know from seeing the movie why that really potent factor in the thing exists. I want to challenge Peter Williams on something, unless I'm usurping someone else's time.
No, I just wanted to hear Peter on this on this point, and then
Bailey.
Well, see, I think that it shows, number one, you know, as we like to say, that, you know, those black people who come from my perspective, that trying to be acceptable has its limitations. I mean, not only in making movies, but in other areas. That's why we don't spend a lot of time trying to be acceptable, because it has its limitations. I think, number two, despite the fact of, you know, maybe someone like myself feel about the movie, there are some powerful scenes in that movie. There are some powerful scenes that the average white American, despite, and this is where I disagree about the idea that the average white American has not fallen for this new Malcolm X that they're trying to image. They know what Brother Malcolm was saying. They have not gone for a moment for this, you know, this new Malcolm X that everybody, you know, that the intellectuals and the critics are talking about. They know better. And so even when they see, you know, like scenes like that I love to talk to the young people about, the dictionary scene where he looked at the definitions of black and white. That was a powerful scene for an American movie. You don't see too many things in American movie like that. The scene with Bane.
You should describe that scene a little more thoroughly, actually.
Baines was trying to, and by the way, the Baines thing is one of my problems, because it was his brother who introduced him to Elijah Muhammad. And not, you know, a stranger, you know, in the prison. But in this particular scene, Baines is trying to get him to participate and become a member of the Nation of Islam while he's in prison. And so in, to explain to him the treachery of white society, he takes him to a dictionary and looks up the word black and look up the word white, you know, and devil food's cake, you know, is black cake. We're going to blackball you, you know, we're going to blackmail you. And then we're going to, if it's the other cake, it's angel's food cake. And, you know, so there's this whole kind of negative connotations that is put around the word black. To me, it was probably one of the most powerful scenes in the movie, the way that was done. I mean, there were a couple of others that had the same kind of effect on me. And I think that if Spike had focused on that more, had talked about the international thing, had, you know, I mean, when Brother Malcolm was invited to the OAU conference to speak, this was a major thing. No other black American until that time had been invited to participate. Not to participate, but to attend, and was allowed to distribute an information. And according to him, they passed a resolution condemning the treatment of black people in this country by the United States. So if he had put more of those kinds of things, and to me, they are dramatic. I mean, when he got off that plane in Paris, I talked to a brother who was there waiting for him in the airport named Carlos Moore. And Carlos say that they were waiting for him inside the terminal, and they heard a French journalist come in and say that he was not going to be allowed in. So they ran out of the, and they looked down and they saw them take him off the plane, put him take him to the other end of the airport and put him on a plane going back to London. So they then ran into this, to the terminal and called London and told London that he was on his way back. Now this was the Organization of Afro-American Unity in Paris. He was going to be speaking before the Organization of Afro-American Unity in Paris. These were basically black people from this country, from Africa, and from the Caribbean who had formed this group in Paris. And to me, that's dramatic, you know, and would have made a great scene in a movie. Mm-hmm. And to not put it in was puzzling to me, because once again, by not doing this, I believe, quieted down or negated the role that the United States government and the vital interest they had in seeing Malcolm X no longer around.
I'm just wondering if you, I mean, I thought some of that stuff that was missing from the film, I was wondering if that was in the film, if that film would have been made. You know, because I think there's...
That's what I'm talking about.
You know, I mean, because I think that a lot of people want to kind of slight, and I'm not saying you're doing this, but kind of want a slight Spike about not putting this in and not putting that in. And I think a lot of that is why the movie didn't get made before now. And I also think that there's some, and I wonder kind of how you feel about this, I think that there's some value to how conventional the film is. And like you say, the scene about the black and the white, and some of the speeches where Malcolm X is really talking about self-image and, you know, what you see when you look in the mirror and those kinds of things, which really, I mean, have never been said before in an American movie.
Yeah.
And this movie also, to me, has the potential of being like on television on Saturdays in 10 years, so that, you know, young people that are growing up will see that, and they'll see those scenes with the dictionary, and they'll see someone really challenging our own assumptions about who we are as African Americans. And I think that, I mean, the myth aspect of it, I think is important. And I was wondering how you felt about it. I mean, I didn't know Malcolm X, so that's my relationship to it.
Well, this is when I, you know, when I'm saying things that are left out, I'm not doing this so much to be critical of Spike, mm-hmm. As such, because as I said before, you know, understanding, you know, where we live and the system, the Malcolm X movie that I would like to see is not going to be financed by Warner Brothers. I mean, that's the bottom line. It's not going to be financed by Warner Brothers.
Juan Williams, your thoughts on why this movie seems to have flared out so quickly?
Well, I think a lot of people were disappointed. I think Jacquie said that people were disappointed, black and white, in terms of the conventionality of the film, its length, the sting to this movie before it was made was the idea that it was going to be such a red-hot, angry, in-your-face, you know, to hell with white people type of movie, and that they were going to focus in on that part of Malcolm X and blow that part out of proportion, I think, to the reality of him, but blow that part out of proportion and focus on it and use it to condemn American society and to point out the oppressive tactics of American society, and therefore people were going to be outraged, people were going to be threatened, that the doors to the cinema needed to be guarded. That was the power of the movie, and I don't think in that kind of current political discourse, it didn't accomplish that end at all.
So then people were disappointed, you mean?
Well, I think people were disappointed who wanted the film as a vehicle for that kind of discussion. I think that's why Peter might be disappointed. I'm disappointed with when I hear Peter say that he approves of someone sitting at a dinner table with an artist and saying that he might be scorned or somehow treated like Salman Rushdie or assassin or something for something he might do in the course of his art. I don't think there's any excuse for that kind of thing. I think it downplays the idea that art could be repressed or oppressed in our society, and then you might make excuses and say, well, I want the art to do this or do that, which is the myth-making function that this film has to fulfill for Malcolm X. But to my mind, that's corrupt, and it doesn't serve any good purpose. It serves the purpose of saying to people, this film is really hagiography. It has nothing to do with reality. It has everything to do with what some people want to say to white American society in 1993, as opposed to a true artistic document about a tremendous life.
Well, see, we probably could never agree, Juan, because I think that art is propaganda. I think that art is propaganda. When I go to see a movie as a child, and I saw those Tarzan movies, and I'm sitting there cheering Tarzan and Cheetah as they wiped out a whole group of African warriors. You know, I mean, to some people that's art. To me, that was propaganda. You know, and I know that people are making decisions about that, and those decisions are made today about what is. There are certain things about Jewish people in this country you're not gonna put in a movie, I don't care how artistic you are, because of the power they have to stop it, you know, and other groups. And so I don't get upset by artists not being able to do everything they want, because no artist can do everything that he or she wants in this society. We have less boundaries than anyone else.
So what are you going to do then? You're going to hold a gun to the head of every artist, and especially every black artist and black writer in America, and say, you must be politically correct or you don't serve the cause? I think that's crazy.
I don't say anything to them.
You said something's going on with Jewish Americans. You got so much Jewish. I want to know what it is that we don't see about Jewish Americans. Okay. I saw a movie the other day on TV about white guys having sex with black women and misogyny in this country.
Let me tell you about something about myself so that we'll be very clear on this. I have reached a state in my life that I am only interested in, I am not interested in journalists, writers, artists, farmers, lawyers, doctors, who describe themselves as, I am not a black artist, I am an artist who happens to be black. I will not criticize those people, because as far as I'm concerned, I believe in letting any black person be whatever they want to be. I personally am interested in black artists. That's all I'm interested in. I will not argue with the artist. In fact, I told someone that once who said to me, I was doing an article on actors and told me that they were an actor who happens to be black. And so I told him, I said, fine, then I will not interview you, because when I get an assignment to do an article on actors who happen to be black, I'll give you a ring. I'm interested in black actors. I'm interested in black actors. And so you will not find me, that statement that you're talking about, I would never make it, because I did not expect, unlike what you just said, I did not expect, Juan, this movie to be the movie on Malcolm X that I would want to make. You would be an idiot to think that Warner Brothers is going to put up $30 million to do the kind of movie on Malcolm X that would do the things that I believe and that would show the Malcolm X that I feel as though I knew. I just never expected that. I don't expect a black journalist on the Washington Post, you know, to be able to do the kind of articles that I think need to be done. If he gets one in every now and then, I give him credit. But I do not criticize him because, you know, he can't do those kind of articles. I don't expect the Washington Post to be an instrument for black liberation. And I didn't expect this Warner Brothers movie to be. I feel as though Spike should be given credit. I think he got as much as he could, considering the circumstances. But I do criticize some things that I think that he might have gotten into the movie that were not there.
Okay, a couple... go ahead, Juan. You, you,
Well, let me say this. If you have questions, come to the microphone in the center aisle now, so we'll know how many of you there are, and we can start adjusting to that reality. In the meantime, I want Juan to have a chance to answer. I want Christopher to have an opportunity to raise his point with Peter, and Jacquie was trying to say something, too.
My thing has to do with what they're talking about.
Okay, well, why don't you go next, then?
Go ahead.
I just wanted to say one thing about what Juan said, because I think when you look at a Hollywood film that, I mean, I don't think that anybody should be threatened with their life about having nudity in their films, but, I mean, Spike Lee's already been told a number of things that he can and cannot do. And I think it's kind of dangerous to talk about Hollywood as art anyway. You know, I mean, this is not like I'm at home painting, you know, a watercolor. I mean, these are very political decisions that are economically and politically mandated. And I think for somebody to threaten you with your life is one thing, but Warner Brothers was threatening with no money. I don't think that it's an issue of being politically correct. It's an issue of creating something in a capital-intensive marketplace.
You know? Well, that's what we're talking about. And it's contradictory, though, what you're saying to what Peter's saying, because you're saying that the economics of it would dictate the kind of film that would be made, and yet at the same time, Peter's saying, well, he didn't expect anything out of the film because Warner Brothers was willing to put up the $30 million, and eventually I think it rose to $40 million, money from other sources that,
but I'm saying economically were back
in the film. So you see, I mean, there's a contradiction in terms of what's being said here, but it all comes back to this idea that I think has been best articulated here by Peter, that somehow the film it would have served best as propaganda, and that the failure of the film in his mind is that it didn't serve that purpose. And then he will say that if Spike Lee would say that he's a filmmaker who happens to be black as opposed to a black filmmaker, then somehow you would never expect anything from such a person.
Every film is propaganda from my perspective.
Right.
Every film.
So there is no such thing as art. That's right. So there would be no such thing as an artistic film about Malcolm X. I disagree. I think you could do that.
Propaganda can be done artistically.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with that. Because, I mean,
I think you could do a film that would challenge American society, be less conventional, and I think the film could have done much more in that way. I am very concerned, though, when I see people who would take every effort of a, let's say, a Richard Wright or now a Spike Lee and say that it does not conform to their standards of how black America should be presented and therefore ill serves the community. I think that is basically putting every artist in some sort of harness that would limit their creativity.
I agree with you, but there are more scripts in Hollywood that do accurately challenge the status quo and that do accurately represent African American life in a more full and rich, you know, kind of way that will never be made. I mean, the scripts are there, the people are there to produce them, and they're not made because those decisions are made by Hollywood. You know, it's an economic and political system that, I mean, it's a reality.
I don't want to cut anybody off, but we face some realities of people who want to ask questions.
Okay.
And I think maybe some of our other points will come out through the answers to what I hope will be the brief questions that will be stated. And Christopher, I promise we'll get back to the point you want to make. So tell us who you are and ask a quick question, please.
My name is Aaron Brickman, and I'm a student here at AU in the School for International Service. Mr. Bailey, I agreed with most of what you said up until the point about Jewish Americans. Unfortunately, I lost all respect for you as soon as you said that. I would like you to expand on the point about Jews that we don't know about. What, in your mind, do we not know about the Jews of this country, sir?
Well, you know, first of all, your losing respect for me does not cause me a lot of problems. But
you do owe him an answer.
What I said was that the Jewish community in this country is very, very powerful, and I admire that power because they are able to protect and defend their interests. And if we could only do it in the same way, and there are movies you see all the time when we about the Jewish community fighting to keep certain things in the history books. When people start challenging the Holocaust and writing things that are different, they go after them tooth and nails. And I want to make it very clear, I am not criticizing that. I think that is exactly what a group has to do to protect its interests. I'm only saying that we, and by we I mean black people, should follow that same strategy when promoting and defending our interests in this society. That's all I am saying.
Why don't you answer the question, Peter? He said to you, what don't we know about Jewish people in America?
What
about Anglo-Saxon people? What don't we know about black people? That's not a question.
Okay.
What don't we know about Jewish people? What are you saying?
Sir, all I was asking was for you to answer the direct.
Okay, then what?
The question.
What don't we know about Jewish people? What don't we know about black people? What don't we know about Anglo-Saxons? What don't we know about Polish people? I mean, there are a lot of things that we don't know about a lot of people in this country. I don't really understand. I personally, I'm serious. I do not understand the question.
Well, if I may interpret.
Pat. I have no problems answering it if someone will make it clear.
Pat, step in.
It seemed to me that what he was saying is that you raised the point. You said in an earlier statement, mm-hmm. there are things that you could not portray in a film about Jewish people in America. And I think he was asking, what are those things?
Okay, I want to ask you a question. Could I, as a black filmmaker, make a film in this country that said that the Holocaust is a myth? Could I, as a black filmmaker, make a film that even suggests that?
What would that be telling people about Jews that they didn't know?
I'm asking that question.
But I don't think you're answering the question that has been asked now by two people of you to further explain the statement that you made. You made a statement. Why won't you answer the question about the statement you made?
I don't understand the question. What about Jewish people we don't know? What?
You said that. You're the one who
I
said that.
I did not say that.
Well, in that case, I think we can move on.
I
think we're going to move on.
Let me close very quickly. What I was saying, if it was misinterpreted, I was saying I was admiring the ability and the power of the Jewish people in this country to promote and defend their interests. What I was doing.
I think we'll take that as a clarification and move on to the next question.
Raul Kohlberg, University of D.C. Learning Resources faculty. I'd like to direct a question to Mr. Freeman with regard to his portrayal of Elijah Muhammad. I wondered if the script as you got it remained substantially the same or changed at all in the process of making the film. And was there anything particular that you were striving to do in a portrayal of Mr. Muhammad? Were you satisfied, and did you try for any particular historic aspect that you were portraying in the character?
Well, I'm content. The thought occurred that if I had gotten that one wrong, I'd take the next fruit truck to Oklahoma or somewhere. It was a difficult task, as you might imagine. Elijah had a fourth grade education. He did not have a grand command of English grammar. Many things he said were not grammatically said well. However, the transcripts of his speeches were all cleaned up so that what was important was his message and not just how he said it. So I had to sort of try to walk a line between what people expected of him, the ones who knew him, and how he sounded and how he talked, and to try not to in any way make a chance for other people to say that this was an illiterate man and that he had nothing really that was important to say that would have swayed so many people, when in fact I think he did, and I think he articulated it very well in his own way. So that was my task.
Let me ask a follow-up question there, Al. Did you feel political pressure?
No.
Of the sort that was described before on Spike Lee? Did you feel that if you portrayed Elijah Muhammad as too unsympathetic a character that you would have problems?
No. Spike jokingly said Farrakhan was very interested in the portrayal of Elijah Muhammad, but I never took that seriously. And clearly there were enough of audio tapes and videotapes of Elijah where the man was very clear and his ideas, the manner of how he started putting things together, and we put those in the film. So those were the changes that were made there. After all, most of the scenes, except for the public scenes and the rallies and all that, were just with me and Denzel behind closed doors. Mm-hmm. Both men were dead, so we didn't really know what they said to each other. We could only surmise from the events that we know about that happened before and after those meetings. So I think people are generally satisfied that we got it somewhat close. And I am too. I'm relieved. You know, it occurred to me that many people, especially Elijah's followers, really deified the man. They had him way up on a pedestal. He was expected to say something profound every moment he opened his mouth. And that had to put an awful lot of pressure on him. And I thought perhaps that that isolated him a little bit, because there must have been times when he didn't have profound things to say, and in whom could he confide? So that made him human for me, and therefore made him accessible as somebody to play.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Jason Tan, and I'm a sophomore at the School of Communication here. Mr. Bailey, if I understand you correctly, what I understood you to say was that Spike was somewhat in a catch-22 situation in making Malcolm X, in that his attempts to make the Malcolm X that you and I believe much more of the black community who knew Malcolm, whom you wanted to see portrayed on the screen, that was not going to happen because of Hollywood's its ability to more or less to actually approve or disapprove what goes on the screen, especially with Warner Brothers putting $30 million into the film itself. I was wondering if exactly you see this this type of catch-22 as something that's a statement that a blanket situation for all of the black community, and it's how this relates to your comments on empowerment of the black community itself.
I basically, as I said earlier, did not believe for a moment that this movie was going to be the kind of movie that I personally would want to see on Malcolm X, or would make if I were able to make a movie on Malcolm X, because I just don't expect Warner Brothers to do such a thing. It's on other levels. I'm a journalist. I don't expect the New York Times to be an instrument for black liberation. So when, you know, I don't expect CBS, you know, American University, you know, places of these types to be instruments of black liberation. So those black people who work at these institutions and who work as Spike did with this movie, I believe they do the best they can do, and whatever little bit you can get out of that, you get it. But for me to sit back and say that American University is going to be, you know, a black college and going to become an instrument for the empowerment of black people, I would have to be an idiot.
Okay, what exactly would be the best suggestion of yours to get for black industry to
is for the black people in this country to pull themselves together and develop themselves politically, economically, and culturally as a group of people. And then once you do that, then you can begin, you can deal with every other group of people in this country on any level that either of you choose to. I'm saying.
Next question, please.
I wanted to say initially, I totally agree with your statement, Mr. Bailey. My name is Martina Cartwright, and I'm chairperson of the Black Law Students Association here at the American University. And as a young African-American woman, I can't say that the movie Malcolm X satisfied me totally. I didn't look at it as just pure entertainment or some type of educational facility from which I learned a great deal about Malcolm X. Borrowing a statement from Mario Van Peebles about his movie New Jack City, I looked at it as edutainment. You know, where it both educated and entertained. But I know I certainly walked away from the movie feeling somewhat confused, very, just like I'd been left, you know, totally unsatisfied. And the one thing that I felt like I, like a lot of African Americans like myself, walked away from the movie doing was researching. I went and I spoke to individuals who lived around that particular time who were involved in the black movement at that time. I read as many books as I could to learn everything about Malcolm X, to understand the man, and to understand more about why he so appeals to young African Americans. And I think his appeal to us is the fact that he emphasized not just self-importance, but self-empowerment. Us taking charge of ourselves, taking charge of our community, giving back to our communities. I guess I just wanted to probably get some input from the panelists on that.
Okay, my name...
I don't think... Does anyone want to comment on that?
I just want to say...
Mr. Bailey.
I just want to say amen.
And Christopher, do you have something you wanted to say?
Well, actually, yes, if you'll say amen, then I think it might be the occasion for my slight but I hope noticeable dissent. Look, everybody knows what a serious topic this is. We're talking about the struggle for liberation of the only large group of people who did not come to America of their own free will and who used to be property. Okay? You would, I think, be surprised how many people have got that point and appreciate the seriousness of it. The difference I have with you is really when you say that if there's anything good in the movie, it's Brother Lee. If there's anything bad, it is Warner Brothers. I have not heard Mr. Lee say, I'd have made a better film if Warner Brothers didn't give me $40 million. If he wants to say it, he has enough money, and I would hope enough courage to say so. I also think that you're in danger when you say all art is propaganda, of basically saying that all propaganda is art or would be considered artistic by you as long as it was made by black people. Now, that's what you said, you were broadly hinting that no one else's opinion was of very much interest to you, which is, of course, you're right. But I'll give you an example from the movie and the autobiography that will face you, if I'm correct, with a choice. Mm-hmm. On the chickens coming home to roost, which you said you thought tactically should not have been said, the, in my view, perfectly brilliant speech made by Malcolm X about the murder of Kennedy and what it meant in terms of the culture of assassination and destabilization. You said tactically you'd rather that hadn't been made. Actually, the real trouble in real life that Malcolm X got into was over saying that he didn't care about the crash of a plane load of white travel agents in Chicago, because why should he care about a plane load of crackers? Which I think you'll agree is a different statement culturally and intellectually from saying that there was some revenge involved in to the culture of violence in the murder of the president. Now, in the movie, there is a moment, which everyone remembers, where a young, concerned, honky woman of the kind we're all used to condescending to, and anyone who can talk, who can pronounce the word empowerment, knows how to despise people like this. She comes up to Malcolm and his group at Columbia, and she says, look, I would really like to do something to help, and I'd like to know what it is. And he says, nothing. There's nothing you can do. She turns away. And Spike Lee, who dodges all really important political questions in the film, is not above sending racial thrills of this kind through audiences. And so I thought it was appalling that that story, which indeed appears in the autobiography, is only told in the autobiography because Malcolm X says he wishes he now knew where that girl was, because he wished he hadn't said that to her, and he wished he could find her and talk to her. Has little more respect for the opinions of some white people, say, than you do, to make my point direct. And is not going to make innuendos about whether they're Anglo-Saxon, Polish, or Jewish either. In other words, isn't a tribalist. Now, if I ask you this question, do you think that Malcolm X was right to say that in his book about the girl? And if you don't think
so, why not?
You mean
right to say that he was sorry?
That he was sorry, and do you agree that's what he did say? And if not, why not? And if that is the state of affairs in the book, is it Warner Brothers' fault that Spike Lee opens that quotation mark in the film and then fails to close it again and leaves people with a deformed impression of what the politics of the movie and indeed this discussion really are?
Well, I think that he himself said that he was sorry he made that statement.
Yes.
Malcolm X did say, and I have the statement that he made, that those whites who are sincere, this is a change, should work in their own communities. That's what he said. He said that he found that those whites, quote, who accepted Islam, end of quote, had been able to transcend racism. We got to be very careful about what he said about this. So what he did, which by making that statement about sincere, but you would be surprised, I worked in the movement of the 60s, what a difficult time that we had getting that concept through to white people. They all wanted to work in Harlem. And we kept telling them, go to Bayside, go to Bensonhurst, organize out there. That's where you can organize. We can't go out there. They didn't want to hear it. They wanted to come to Harlem. And I tell you very frankly, we regarded that as a missionary concept, and we resented it tremendously. Mm-hmm. And the change in Brother Malcolm from what he was saying when he was in the Nation and what he said with the OEAU was his statement that those whites who were sincere should organize and work in their own communities, because this is where the problem was and where they could be most effective. There were not going to be any white members of the OAAU, the Organization of Afro-American Unity. That I can guarantee you.
Okay.
Next question.
Okay. My name is Salomon Carrasco. I'm a teacher and journalist. I'm interested in intellectual level rather than just discussion. I know Malcolm Moose was radical. I read all literature. This propaganda, whatever, the movies, maybe for integration going on, is good also. But my question is this. We know already how he radical was in the past. I see the present. Now, as you try to be expert explaining us how we have to resolve these problems in the future, I'm interested in present to the future rather than be past. Anyone, I like to intellectually put you with your ideology, with your theory, what your philosophy is. I like to know.
Juan?
You want to know how to resolve the issue of race in American society?
That's the old problems we have.
Well, I have to ask you for a brief answer.
Well, I think that part of the way to resolve the problem is through empowerment, as we've been talking about, a certain sense of educational and making sure that people have equitable opportunities to live full lives, so that we redress in some way the historical advantage that comes from the fact that black people in this country were property and were legally, through government enforcement, segregated and oppressed in terms of educational and economic opportunities, that the government has to take some steps in that direction. At the same time, you have to have this learning experience, I think, of exposure to people so that there's more of an opportunity for people in this society to become acquainted with each other and their talents rather than to delve into the stereotypes about blacks or Jews or any other group that I think are very, very damaging. And I think all of that has to come about as you have a struggle over power, because much of this has to do with the unstated equation that power has been held in certain hands in this society, especially wealth is power, for a great deal of time for the history of this country, and that we have to somehow address them within a capitalistic system that basic inequity.
Thank you.
Next question. And if we could try to keep the questions brief, I'd appreciate it, because we're really over our time, but I want to allow people to have their
opportunity. My name is Ernest Johnson. I'm with the Leadership Conference on Civil Rights. I'm chairman of the Statehood Grassroots Committee here in Washington, D.C. American University is my alma mater. I'm out of the School of Justice also. And by the way, one of my fellow students and a member of the School of Communications from Southeast Washington, Russell Williams, two-time Oscar winner, did the sound on the movie Malcolm X. So I think he should have got an Oscar just because he's from Southeast.
He's had two Oscars and he's very...
Yeah, he should have had a third one. When you come out of Southeast, you need three. I haven't seen the movie, to be quite honest. I haven't found the need to rush out to see it. I will get a chance. I think, at my age, I've kind of like lived the experience. And I'm glad to have lived during the lifetime of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Sometimes it kind of like bothers me when we have these discussions and then they kind of like almost denigrate to the point of where they did just now. I don't think that dialogue kind of like helps anything. And I think that we have a problem with looking at Malcolm X and Martin Luther King in terms of absolutism. They have to be absolutely correct. They have to be absolutely perfect. And I think that that's unrealistic to look at anybody in that manner. And I think what we need to begin to do is to start to look at the good in people and the goodness that they do and see if we can uplift humanity, black people in particular, and all people in general. And I think when we start to look at things from that perspective, we begin to get more things done in this society. Right here in Washington, the last 4 years, we've had 2,500 people killed. We have 200,000 people unemployed or underemployed. 30% of our population is on public assistance. Only 30,000 people make over $60,000 and above. 11,000 people on a 5.5-year waiting list for public housing. The list goes on and on and on. So I'm saying dialogue is good. Dialogue has its place. But the thing that I take from Malcolm, the thing that I take from Martin Luther King, is a commitment for activism, a commitment to be involved, a commitment to change and bring some things about. I can't really imagine Malcolm X or Martin Luther King sitting on a panel even discussing a movie. They would be somewhere trying to change and bring about the uplifting of our society.
I'll take the blame for the fact that people are here on the panel.
Oh, no, it's a good form. I'm not
But we trust that they will do important other things.
It's a real good form, and, you know, this is my alma mater, and you have some of the people on this panel that I really love and respect. I really do. I think time for criticism and all of that is way past. I'm just saying that the problems in Washington and the problems of America is going to require that all of us begin to kind of, like, get involved and see what we have in common rather than always what we don't have in common, always criticizing each other, always at each other's throats. You know, we're in a real serious time in our society where we got some major problems, and I'd just like to see us come together. I just wanted to say that.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Good evening. My name is Asantua Nkrumah Ture, and I'd like to give thanks and praises to Brother Peter Bailey. I agree with you, brother. There were a lot of different things left out of the movie. You lived through it and you knew Malcolm. As someone who's been researching Malcolm, though, as the brother said, the things that were left out were very significant. Malcolm X made a speech called Message to the Grassroots. That wasn't there. Malcolm X met Fidel Castro at the Hotel Teresa in Harlem. That wasn't there. Malcolm X visited Ghana, Nigeria, Senegal, correct me if I'm wrong, brother, and some other countries in Africa, and he met the revolutionary leaders of that time, Nkrumah, Sekou Touré, Modibo Keita, Amilcar Cabral, Oliver Tambo, et cetera, et cetera. He also met Nasser when he was in Egypt. He wasn't just riding around on a camel as a tourist, okay? When Malcolm X was in Egypt meeting with Nasser, they had meetings and discussions about Zionism. Malcolm X wrote an article called Zionist Logic, and in that article he equated Zionism with American imperialism, American dollarism. He supported the rights of the Palestinians. That was not in the movie for obvious reasons. So to get back to this gentleman's question here, art is a form of propaganda. It sells an idea. It gets people thinking certain types of things. And because these things and others were left out, people have a certain view about Malcolm. It's a distorted view, and they're making a view based on a lie. And for our young people, for African young people, that's very dangerous. We want the truth to our young people. And to this, the gentleman back here, I know for a fact that Warner Brothers put political pressure on Spike Lee about that movie because they asked him, a brother who was a consultant to the movie, how are you going to deal with Malcolm and his visit to the Middle East? Well, that was an obvious reason for that question. They didn't want to have on that film Malcolm talking about Palestinians. That's a bad word these days, particularly in light of the Middle East peace talks. You will never see in a movie in America anyway a man named Lenny Brenner, who's a European anti-Zionist Jew. And he speaks all around the country, but you don't have him on PBS. There are a number of Jews around the world who are of different races who were organizing and speaking out against the creation of the State of Israel, but you will not have them on TV too. So as the brother said, art and propaganda are very related, and for our people, as oppressed and exploited as we are, we have to make a conscious decision that art and every other skill that we have as a people must serve our liberation, and if it does not, you will face the consequences.
Can I just make a... No. I want to say, repeat what I said earlier. I admire, and I'm using this term deliberately, I admire the Jewish people for their ability to promote and defend their interests. I only wish that we as black people could be as effective. That was the point I was making earlier, and I want to repeat it. That is what I was saying. I admire their ability to defend and promote their interests. That's exactly what a group of people are supposed to do. And this country would be in better shape, and we would be in better shape if we were as tenaciously in our abilities to defend and promote our interests.
I think we'll go to the next question. If I could ask you, please, I really don't want to deny anyone a right to speak, but it's getting late, we're over our time, and we really have not opened the microphone for rhetoric, but for addressing the subject of the forum. Thank you.
Hakeem Muhammad is my name. Mr. Freeman, I think you did an excellent job with portrayal of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Thank you.
I want to give you those kudos first. Brother Bailey, I want to also say that I think you're right on the mark. We are aware that, again, the Jewish lobby is very, very significant here in this country. I also want to get a comment from you in terms of the portrayal of Elijah Muhammad with regard to Malcolm X, Brother Malcolm X. And also, what is your view in terms of the portrayal of the Nation of Islam after the showing of Malcolm X?
Well, it's very difficult to talk about Elijah Muhammad in that kind of way, because I regard Malcolm X as a man, as a great black man. The people who believe in Elijah Muhammad regard him as almost like a God figure. And it is as difficult, and I've stopped arguing with members of the Nation about that, because whereas I can admit Brother Malcolm's flaws and some things that I felt as though he could have done differently, they cannot admit that Elijah Muhammad could do anything wrong because they regard him as a god, any more than any other people who are involved in a religious thing can admit that their leader, that religious leader did something wrong. So it's very difficult to discuss that on any level. So I stick with Brother Malcolm and as a man, and I look upon him as a great man, but I do not look upon him as a god. And he did make mistakes, and I'm prepared to say this. But that does not take away from what he was preaching and what he was saying and the righteousness of what he was trying to get us to do as a people in order to empower ourselves in this country.
Next question.
My name is Tyra Finnell. I go to Duke Ellington School of the Arts. First, I would like to speak as an individual. I have two comments to make. I wanted to refer back to the comment made about the burning house and how there were some accusations as it not being true. I was not aware of this until tonight when it was said, but I saw something different than the surface meaning. I saw that coming to the point where Malcolm realized that universalism was the way. Spike Lee was trying to show through those two burning houses, the one when the KKK burned it, and then the other when it was inferred that the Nation of Islam may have had some part in it, that evil lies within the soul and not within the color. And I think that was a very important point, especially at the end of the movie when Malcolm X had come to the realization that universalism was the way. My second comment is coming from an African-American student and a product of the District of Columbia public school system. You all were talking, I forgot what I was gonna say.
All right.
I guess I'll have to come back, but that was the main point I was trying to make about the house. I think you all missed that point, or maybe it just came from me, but that was very important to me. Oh no, I know what my point was. You all said that the Spike Lee movie was supposed to cause some sort of confusion within the Nation with the youth and all that stuff. I think it didn't for a number of reasons, but the main reason is that I think it numbified the youth so much that when they left that movie, the only thing they could do was think. I think it was a little bit sketchy, but as someone who wasn't that educated about Malcolm X, I did read the book. I saw that he was extremely powerful, and that gave me a lot of pride in my race as a student, something that I rarely see in the movies now with all the subliminal messages. So I think it numbified the youth so much that they couldn't react physically. It was all a mental learning experience. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we'll just take these last two.
My name is Nicole Morgan, and I'm a student here at the School of Communications. I'm a broadcast journalism major. I have two brief questions. First, for Mr. Bailey, if you can briefly summarize some of the changes that took place within the Nation after Malcolm X was killed and after Spike Lee's movie has come out. And from the critics, I would like to know if they're ever going to pull themselves together to recognize good art when they see it, and put their differences aside about how it's done, and to give awards where they're due.
You said about
the changes in the Nation of Islam after Malcolm X was killed and since the movie has come out.
Okay, first of all, I think I was not a member of the Nation. I was never a Muslim, even when I was working with Brother Malcolm, when he formed the Muslim Mosque Incorporated. I was a part of the political, economic, cultural organization. I was never a Muslim, just as I did not consider myself as a Christian. I had kind of gotten away from all of the organized religions. I tell you very frankly, from watching the Nation of Islam when I first saw it in 1962, when it was the most powerful looking black organization that I had ever seen, and the most impressive black organization that I had ever seen. I think that on February 21st, 1965, not only was Malcolm X assassinated, but the Nation of Islam was effectively eliminated as a major force in this country. I don't think the organization has really been very much since that time, at least compared to what it was before then.
And your question for the critics, I'm sorry.
If they foresee a change in how the Academy reviews movies, and if they can give Spike Lee or any other artist awards that they deserve as a result of the work that they accomplish.
Well, actually, the Academy is made up of 5,000 highly idiosyncratic individuals, I'm afraid. And although there are certain threads that run commonly through what they do quite often, the fact of the matter is that even this year, when they ignored Malcolm X, there were other films among those nominated for Best Picture that were some of the best movies of the year. Malcolm X, incidentally, although I've talked a lot about its flaws here, was on my 10 best list, for instance, because I too found it a very powerful experience. I think now the average Academy voter has more of a problem with Spike Lee individually, just like they do with Steven Spielberg. For different reasons, probably. And he'll probably have to be old and gray before they recognize him for his body of work, which is probably what will also happen to Steven Spielberg, another popular and very visible filmmaker who doesn't seem to get any respect from the Academy, whatever
they'll get. They'll get Lifetime Achievement Awards.
Yeah, I think Spike Lee will end up with a Lifetime Achievement Award when he's about 75 years old. But,
do you want to add anything to that?
The one thing I also think about the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences is it's not exactly unpolitical itself. And I think when you look at the kinds of movies that win Academy Awards, they're kind of reinforcing why Hollywood is there. And I think no matter how conventional this film is, someone said earlier something about forgetting and remembering Malcolm X, and that the majority of the people that are on that committee are not black and are, you know, old enough to remember seeing Malcolm X on television, and I don't think they've forgotten that. So no matter how palatable the movie might be, I think there's still a cultural memory of Malcolm X that's not. So I think that has a lot to do with it as well.
Thanks. Last question.
Mr. Speaker, I know I'm the last speaker here, so I hope I don't monopolize the rest of your time. Good to see you again, Mr. Wood. The 60s. Very, very pivotal time in American history. I wasn't even there, but when I look back 28 years ago, as a matter of fact, a week ago today, 28 years ago to the day of Malcolm X's assassination, it's incredible the things that have happened since then. The Kennedy murders, the revelations about Hoffa and his dictatorship of the FBI. It makes me think that, it makes me think about our world, our society, and if we're capable of changing. To paraphrase Rodney King, look at Malcolm X, and as a young black man, as a young black male student, I'm inspired by his fortitude, his integrity, maybe not in every aspect of his life, but in most situations, and how this man overcame and made a metamorphosis. So I guess my question to you all, in sum, is are there any of his philosophies that could be applied to today's stage, our world scene, our international setting?
Okay, good question to close on. The relevance of Malcolm X today, if we could do that briefly, I'd appreciate it.
Well, I think that, in fact, a great deal of Malcolm X's power in the current debate comes from the idea that people look to him and say, well, how did Malcolm X deal with this as someone who, without a doubt, was in favor of making the most of for black people, doing the best possible for black America. Because no one says we doubt that Malcolm was really about being black. In a time when so much of black identity is splintered, no one doubts it. So what would Malcolm have done? How would he have handled this situation or that? Which is a very interesting issue, because Malcolm was very much a man who believed strongly in family values, strongly in the idea of not accepting social programs from the government, not looking to white America for redemption, but looking to the idea of black people working together black people building up themselves economically, educationally, their children. In all these ways, I think he offers a very strong answer at a time when the issue of identity and values are in crisis in black America.
Anyone else want to address that question? Christopher?
I think one of the reasons for the disappointment felt by audiences who've seen the film and for the absence of the lasting effect that some might have hoped for from it is precisely to do with the question that was just asked. In fact, where does it take you? For example, I mean, Juan Williams mentioned this, but he could have extended his remarks and said, you know, family values, abstinence from alcohol and drugs, sexual continence, small business was another aspect of it. I've read countless articles in the conservative and Reaganite press in the recent months saying, why aren't more black people like Malcolm X? And these are not, all of them are trying to be funny or trying to be teasing. Indeed, they are saying, in one of my least favorite terms of the moment, as a role model, people might do well to emulate him. Now, if his points were as easily assimilable as that, then I don't think one can count him as a revolutionary. On the business of Islam, it's been proved by every society that's tried it that Islam is not a basis on which you can organize a society. In fact, no religion can ever organize a state or a nationality. That's been proved by Christians time and again. There are many experiments going on now of different kinds of Islam. All of them are either failing or have failed calamitously. So as far as a preacher of Islam is concerned, not a success. I would, however, at the risk of seeming ridiculous, and I almost feel that I have an emanation of feeling ridiculous from my skeptical neighbor, Peter Bailey. But if you ask me, what does Malcolm X mean to me? And if you can suppress your titters, I can say this much. Everywhere you look in the world at the moment, whether it might be Bosnia or Haiti or the former Soviet Union or West Germany, now unified Federal Republic of Germany, you can see there are always basically two kinds of people. There are those who think that the tribe into which they were born is the main thing about themselves, and nothing can change that. And if they could only like themselves more for it, congratulate themselves more about it, they would be only too happy. And there are people who realize that internationalism is not just a desirable thing, it's actually the only way the world can be organized, and in practical terms, is the only way it can be. And there are people who've had the experience of crossing that gulf. And Malcolm X, who had everything that white racism could throw at him, refused to let the racists be his teachers. And that is why his example, in the moral and exemplary sense, is undimmed. And that, I think, would be an excellent way in which to remember him, as an example of a road along which a lot of people have still got a lot of traveling to do.
The Malcolm X that I knew and that I remember was a man, and the reason that his philosophy is still strong among some black people is because they're eternal. He was about self-determination for us as a group. He was about self-respect. He was about accepting responsibility. He was about self-defense. I like those black conservatives that ask about that. He was about self-defense. He was about internationalizing, hooking up black people, hooking up with people of African descent around the world. So he gave us a broader vision. He was about working relationships with people who shared mutual interests. That's what Malcolm X was about. Malcolm X believed in family values. He did not believe that we should be dependent upon the government, but he also did not believe that we should not get our rightful share of government monies. As far as I am concerned, and what I learned from Brother Malcolm, there's no such thing as the United States government giving black people anything. We give this government more money in taxes every year than they give us back in goods and services, so they never give us a penny. Malcolm X would understand that, and he taught us that. Anything we get from the government, people get welfare, that's my money they're getting back. It's not a gift from the United States government, on no level, scholarships, nothing. And everybody in this country gets tax money, and we should get our rightful share. But we should not be dependent on it. But we should demand our rightful share of tax money. Malcolm X taught us that. Malcolm X talked about responsibility. There's no way you can be sniffing cocaine and talking about you believe in Malcolm X. There's no way you can be on drugs. He regarded people who did that as having basically become what the system wanted them to be. That's the way they got those young brothers into the fruits of Islam. That's, everybody say, how did they get those guys changed and organized? You know how they got them changed? By telling them, by doing what you are doing, you are becoming what the white man want you to be. That was the major message they gave to them over and over again to make them change. It's no mystery as to how they were able to get those guys, the same way that guy did to Brother Malcolm in prison. Nobody wants to talk about that. By doing what you're doing, Baines told him, you have become what the white man wants you to be. And that's why he changed. But we're not going to use that approach to reach the young brothers today. Because see, that's not universal enough. We're not going to use that kind of approach that was successful in transforming many young men and making them into more responsible young black men. But we will not use that today because that's considered not universal, and that would not get you, you know, any kind of accolades. I don't think for a single moment that the real Malcolm X is accepted by the black people in this country, whether they're on the liberal blacks or the conservative blacks. None of them accept the real Malcolm X, who was about doing things and building the power of the black community. Thank you.
Stay with us for just a minute. I want to welcome everybody again to our reception on the first floor in the private dining room, first floor of Mary Graydon Center. And I want to thank our sponsors, the Xerox Foundation, the Washington Gas Light Company, and Cable Holdings. Our next forum, the last for this semester, will be in this room at 7:30 on Tuesday, April 13th. And I hope you'll join us. Those who are not on our mailing list or do not routinely receive information about the forums, there are cards available in the lobby as you leave. I want to thank the panelists for this evening, Juan Williams, Pat Dowell, Al Freeman Jr., Jacquie Jones, Peter Bailey, and Christopher Hitchens for joining us. Thank you all.